Okay, here's Harrison again. Harrison, brilliant intellectual, race and class conscious, radical internationalist. He defines himself as a radical internationalist. A. Philip Randolph and others refer to him as the father of Harlem radicalism in the period when Harlem is considered the center of radical black thought and the international Negro Mecca. This is what people are saying about Harlem in this period. And I argue he is a key ideologue because he is class radical and race radical. He is a key ideological link in the unity of the civil rights and black liberation movement, civil rights slash black liberation movement. The Martin and Malcolm strands, right? They kind of come together in Harrison. We'll get into this. Joel A. Rogers, world's great men of color. Joel A. Rogers, and he knew Harrison extremely well, in World's Great Men of Color, Joel A. Rogers describes Hubert Harrison as the foremost Afro-American intellect of his era. That's extraordinarily high praise. It's amidst chapters on Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, William Monroe Trotter, and Marcus Garvey. So extremely high praise. And he goes on to say, and the leader with the sanest program. So first I'm going to talk about Harrison as an intellectual. Then I'm going to talk about Harrison as a radical. Again, these are just opening remarks. I want to get into this in great depth. When Harrison comes to New York in 1900, and we'll get into his Caribbean background next week, he, like so many immigrants, he comes, he's working 5 days a week, a couple of nights, he's an orphan, he's got to make ends meet. He goes to high school because he's got this desire to learn. He goes to high school at night, and the New York World, one of the dailies in New York, runs a headline because he wins these awards. He wins citywide honors in New York City. Genius found in West Indian student. They'd never seen anyone like this, right? Latin honor. He's barely going to school. All right. He spoke or read six languages, and I know this in part from his diary, and because in his papers, by the way, was his diary, which when I said the family gave me all his papers in 1981, 82, they gave me all except one thing. The daughter held it for a while. And that was after I finished a dissertation on Harrison, and I took her out to dinner, and we were sitting down and talking, and she goes, oh, I have one more thing for you, and she gave me his diary, which he had kept since he started it in 1907, this version. So, and it was a total gold mine. So that's when I knew I had two volumes worth of work. It's major, major document. So he read or spoke six languages, including Arabic, and not because he was religious, but because it was a religion of so many people of African descent, right? He was reading, in his last year, he was reading the Quran to be familiar with this, right? He read voraciously. When he dies, the obituary, several of the obituaries, one or two of them commented that it was reported he read several books a day. And you might say, oh, gee, they're just pumping that. But I went through his books. And I also, in my youth, took a speed reading course. He knew how to attack a book. You see his books, and you could see where he honed in. He focused on what sections, what he wanted to deal with. He'd mark it up. He'd interact with it. So I certainly believe it. And his clippings were voluminous and in all kinds of areas, right? So he did read voraciously. And when Rogers talks about the foremost Afro-American intellect of his era, Rogers is not speaking loosely. Rogers writes two volumes on World's Great Men of Color, right? He knows who these players are, who these figures are, and what they did. As an orator, Hubert Harrison was a pioneering soapbox orator. He would speak on the street corners. He'd speak indoors also, Cooper Union, places like that. You know, I mean, all over, public libraries, a big, big proponent of free public libraries. But I want to focus on his oratory outdoors right now. History, science, politics, religion, education, literature, theater, evolution, race and class. As a soapbox orator, I just wanted to highlight a couple things to drive this home. He spoke as many as 23 times a week. That's morning, noon, and night, 7 days a week, for the Socialist Party in 1912. That's when Eugene Debs is running for president, and Harrison is the leading black activist in the party. This next one for the occupiers, right? People in the Occupy movement. New York Times, September 13th, refers to September 13th, 1912. It's actually the paper of the 14th. Hubert Harrison, an eloquent and forceful Negro speaker, shattered all records for distance in an address on socialism in front of the stock exchange. His voice carried the furthermost limits of the crowd. He was still going strong at the beginning of the third hour, and he continued on until the big bell closed the exchange. That was an early Occupy movement, right? But unfortunately, the occupiers today are not aware of that history, and I think it would be important, you know, to bring much, much more into that movement, right? He spoke before 50,000 people at Union Square. He spoke all over the city. I'm going to give you a quote from Henry Miller on Harrison when he saw Harrison as a youth at Madison Square, unrivaled, his quantum idol, he refers to him as. And in Harlem, it is Hubert Harrison who pioneers tradition of soapbox oratory that is subsequently picked up by A. Philip Randolph, Chandler Owen, Richard B. Moore, Marcus Garvey, and later Malcolm X. 134th Street and Lenox Avenue, and we have here Marlowe, Issa, Sean, some people who were in, we got petitions outside the Schomburg Center to rename what it was called back then, what it was referred to back then, 134th and Lenox, as Liberty Corner, and to get it renamed Hubert Harrison Way, and it passed unanimously at Community Board 10, and then all of a sudden the bureaucracy stepped in, and a moratorium, and nothing's been done on it, right? So we have to revisit that issue. But that I mean, it should be named for Hubert Harrison, and all the proper procedures were followed, right? Here's Henry Miller, again, as I said, and if people don't know Henry Miller, very important, a semi-autobiographical novelist, my youth, Fred's youth, but he's also a socialist in his youth, right? And here's what he writes. We won't go through all of this, but this is on Harrison. There was no one in those days who could hold a candle to Hubert Harrison, and invariably you'd hear this. Harrison was unrivaled orator. With a few well-directed words, he had the ability to demolish any opponent. He smiled, his easy assurance, great sculptured head, which he carried on his shoulders. He was a man who electrified one by his mere presence. He always retained his self-possession, his dignity. He had a way of placing the back of his hand on his hip, his trunk tilted, his ears cocked to catch every last word of the questioner or heckler. He would bide his time. When the tumult had subsided, there would come that broad smile, a broad, good-natured grin. He would answer his man, always fair and square, always full on like a broadside. Soon everyone would be laughing. So he really could work the crowd. He, brilliant lecturer, spoke not from notes so much. I mean, he just remarkable, right? Remarkable. And there are so many accounts in that biography, I quote from contemporaries on Harrison's oratorical abilities, on his intellect. You will be just utterly shocked to read about this and ask again. You'll constantly be asking, why didn't we know about this before? All right, still on Harrison is a brilliant intellectual. 700 pieces, I mentioned, I'm going to try and get them all up online. As an editor, as a journalist, as an editor, he was editor, not the principal editor, but an editor of The Masses, which is the leading left literary publication of that decade between 1910 and 20. Follow. He was the editor of The Voice, subtitled A Newspaper for the New Negro, 1917 and 19, the first paper of the New Negro Movement. 1917, you read the canon, the canonical literature, New Negro, Alain Locke, 1925. That's what we've been fed. Harrison founds this New Negro Movement 8 years earlier in militant political and social activism, but it's extraordinarily literary. Still, if you're still leaning with that 1925 date, try this. Harrison edits The New Negro, titled New Negro, 1919, an organ of the international consciousness of the darker races, especially the Negro race. It's a monthly publication. The Voice was a weekly. In 1920, he becomes the principal editor of The Negro World. That's Garvey's newspaper, and he reshapes it, and the paper sweeps the globe under his editorship. In the book, A Hubert Harrison Reader, you have some of Harrison's comments on what he did to reshape that publication editorially. And I encourage people to look at that stuff. And in volume two, I will be getting into that in great depth. And his final publication was The Voice of the Negro in 1927. That's publication of his last organizational effort, the International Colored Unity League. And again, we see some parallel with Malcolm later on. For those familiar with Malcolm's life, his last effort is the Organization of Afro-American Unity, the more broadly unitary part. As a critic, Hubert Harrison, he starts writing when he's in high school. This guy's writing letters getting published in the New York Times in 1903. He's in high school. In 1907, he has two articles published on book reviewing on the front page of the New York Times Saturday Review of Books. That's when they did the review of books back then. Now it's the Sunday Review of Books. Eugene O'Neill wins a Nobel Prize for Literature in 1936 after Harrison does a review of The Emperor Jones. O'Neill writes to Harrison, says, "This is fine as a piece as I've seen any theater I have anything to do with, you have a role in," right? You know, high praise, right? As a book reviewer, Hubert Harrison describes himself as the first regular book reviewer in Negro newspaperdom. Regular book reviews. When he's editing the Negro World, all the papers he edits, poetry for the people, book review sections, he's a political activist, but he's got that literary dimension, right? We've located 68 to 70 reviews by Harrison and two members of the National Book Critics Circle, including a fellow named Eric Bank, who I believe lives here in Brooklyn, and Scott McLemy, who's down in DC, writes for Inside Higher Education, two members of the National Book Critics Central Executive Committee or whatever, use quotes from Hubert Harrison on how to review a book on their webpage. They throw them up prominently today, right? But I don't know, and somebody can correct me, or maybe somebody will correct me by what they do, but I don't know a literature course or a black literature course in this country that teaches Harrison. All right, there's O'Neill to Harrison. Here's part of what Harrison says, and you'll get a sense of what kind of intellectual he was. This is just an excerpt from one of his pieces in the New York Times on how to review books. "In the first place, remember that in a book review, you are writing for a public who want to know whether it is worth their while to read the book about which you are writing. They're interested in the book, not so much about your loves and hates. Respect yourself and your office so much that you will not complacently pass and praise drivel and rubbish. Grant that you don't know everything, you still must steer clear." I mean, he's got great integrity he brings to it. It's not, my friend wrote it, so I'm going to praise it. Something like that. "Give honest service. Remember, too, that you can not well review a work on African history if that's the only one you've read. Therefore, read widely, be well informed, get the widest basis of knowledge for your judgment, then back your judgment to the limit." Still very good advice, right? Still talking about Harrison as an intellectual. We okay? Good. "Leading black activist in the Socialist Party. Without doubt, we'll get into that. Leading pioneering black activist in the free thought movement." If people are not familiar with the free thought movement, that's thought unfettered by religion. He breaks from the church, most powerful institution in the black community, and turns to free thought, to science, to address social problems. Next week when we do Harrison in depth, we will go into this in depth. "He's a pioneer black activist in the birth control movement. Speaking on birth control he comes out of the same branch five as Margaret Sanger. In 1914 and 1915, he's speaking on birth control, but he's also aware of the genocidal aspects and the abuses taken towards black women, you know, in the hospital. So he's clear. But when he's speaking on birth control in 1914, up at 181st Street, if people are familiar with that subway station up there, it's got the stairs down, I think, right? So he's there speaking outside that subway station. And according to the report in the Truth Seeker, one of the publications of the Free Thought Movement, they describe it as the Irish cop looks the other way and the gang of rowdies come and attack him, and he's got to take the table leg and defend himself down the stairs, right? And of course, he's the one who gets arrested, you know, story, right? I'm not making light of that. I'm just saying that's what happened. He is, as I said, the founder and the leading force of the New Negro Movement. He's a promoter and aide to black writers and artists. He is a featured lecturer for the New York City Board of Education from 1922 to 1926, basically the only black lecturer. And this is when they were doing adult education at night in the public libraries, in the Y, right? That was a principal form of education for working people. And as a bibliophile and library popularizer, Hubert Harris, he thought libraries, free public libraries, were one of the great institutions in this country. He wrote essays like Read, Read, Read. He's encouraging, you know, the same thing we see later with Malcolm again. And he's a founding officer of the committee of the 135th Street Public Library. The old building is next to the Schomburg Center today, for people who might be familiar with it, right? And Ernestine Rose, one of the librarians, Arthur Schomburg, a friend of Harrison's, James Weldon Johnson. There was a committee set up on the division of Negro literature, history, and prints, which subsequently grew into the Schomburg Center, right? So he's one of the founding officers of that committee, you know. And after he dies, his portrait is hung in the entrance to the library. It's not there now, right? People can't seem to find it, right? But this is how he was revered, the esteem he was held in that period. That's an overview of Harrison as an intellectual. Now we're going to briefly look at Harrison as a radical. This is A. Philip Randolph, 1963, March on Washington. He describes Harrison, the father of Harlem radicalism, again, period when Harlem's considered the center of radical black thought. Hubert Harrison was the major, I'll get into this. He was a major radical influence on A. Philip Randolph, right, and others. Hubert Harrison is the only person in United States history to play signal leading roles in the largest class radical movement and the largest race radical movement of his era. He was the foremost black organizer, agitator, and theoretician in the Socialist Party of New York in 1912. He founds the first organization in the first newspaper, the New Negro Movement. It's like the Black Power Movement 50 years later, as I said earlier. And becomes editor of the Negro World and principal radical influence on the Garvey Movement. Marcus Garvey joins Hubert Harrison's Liberty League. This is the kind of influence Harrison had back then, right? And if people are familiar with Garvey, Garvey doesn't join anyone's organization, right? This is the founding meeting. Somebody was speaking earlier today about Adam Clayton Powell, right? It's the founding meeting of the Harrison's Liberty League in 1917. It's at Bethel AME Church on 132nd Street in Harlem. If you look at the listed speakers, it's Hubert Harrison, Chandler Owen, who's partners with A. Philip Randolph, right? And Adam Clayton Powell, Sr. At this rally, Harrison also invites Garvey up to speak to his first major Harlem crowd. But look at the slogan. Woodrow Wilson had led the U.S. This is going to sound familiar to the younger generation. Bush led us into Iraq to make the Mideast. After that, we didn't believe the weapons for mass destruction. We were told it was to make the world safe for democracy, or make Iraq safe for democracy. Right. Wilson leads us into World War I to make the world safe for democracy. Harrison says, let's make the South safe for democracy, because there's lynching, segregation, disfranchisement. Stop lynching and disfranchisement. So that was the slogan. That was the militancy. And that organization is demanding enforcement, 13th, 14th, 15th Amendment, federal anti-lynching legislation. And Harrison is speaking of armed self-defense 44 years before Robert F. Williams at these meetings. Huh? That's a flyer for the rally, 19th. And this is in June. This is June 12th. In July 4th, the first issue of Harrison's paper, The Voice, comes out.
Is that prominent picture in his book?
This flyer is in there, yeah. Here, again, I mentioned about Harrison, New Negro. Here's just a sample of Harrison's New Negro monthly. Look at some of the titles. The Women of Our Race, Education in West Africa, The White War and the Colored Races, Two Negro Radicalisms. So these are very radical publications he's putting out. 1919, 6 years before Locke, right? Drive home this point about the New Negro Movement and Harrison's role as a founder, and how can somebody write about the New Negro Movement and not mention him? In the book, we have volume one has 180 pages on Harrison and the New Negro Movement. First paper, first organization, publication called The New Negro, right? 1920, the book that I'm redoing with Diasporic Africa Press, look at the title, When Africa Awakes, the inside story of the stirrings and strivings of the new Negro in the Western world. Right? Still, right. Got that point, right? So he profoundly influenced the generation of new Negro militants and common people. In both books I've written, I argue, and no one has seriously challenged, that amongst his generation, Hubert Harrison was the most class conscious of the race radicals and the most race conscious of the class radicals. A very unique combination. This is Hodge Kiernan. It's a very striking photo. This was done in Greenwich Village. He's from Montserrat, a very political activist of that generation, writes for Harrison's publications, writes for Negro World. He's an elevator operator at the Stiglitz Gallery, which was the avant-garde place, right, in that period, and probably the most brilliant man in the building, right? But he talks about Harrison lived with and amongst his people, not on the fringes of their social life. It was Harrison who really, and his voice, that really crystallized the radicalism Negro in New York, exerted a tremendous influence, inspiring the people, sense of race pride and determination. Harrison, who lived on Harlem's most dense, lived with and amongst the people. He's not this talented tenth. He's not up on the hill. He's on the most densely populated block in Harlem. And Kiernan goes on, Harrison was the first Negro whose radicalism was comprehensive enough to include racialism, politics, theological criticism, sociology, education in a thoroughgoing and scientific manner. Hubert Harrison was the major radical influence on A. Philip Randolph, by Randolph's own admission. He was the major radical influence on Marcus Garvey. And this is documented, and you'll read the documentation, volume one, and even much more in volume two. When I grow up, you take those lines of descent, and that is Martin and Malcolm. Because as we know, it is Martin who marches with A. Philip Randolph at his side in the March on Washington movement, and it is Malcolm, whose mother was a reporter for the Negro World, the same paper that Harrison edited a few years later, and whose father was a Garveyite preacher. So we see these important lines of descent, right? I argue, as I stated earlier, he is a key link in the two wings of the civil rights, black liberation struggle, the one basically identified with Martin, one with Malcolm, right? As a radical internationalist, I used this phrase before, it's from Harrison, he's extremely knowledgeable about Africa, Asia, Mideast Americas, and Europe. Richard B. Moore, famed Scottsboro orator, ran the Frederick Douglass bookstore on 125th Street in Harlem, pioneering black socialist, member of the African Blood Brotherhood, of the Communist Party, writes, Harrison was above all a militant black socialist in his steady emphasis on the liberation of the oppressed African and colonial peoples. Winston James, outstanding historian, was at Columbia, is now at UCal Irvine, written a wonderful book, Holding Aloft the Banner of Ethiopia, about early 20th century Caribbean radicalism. James writes, Harrison had confidence and humility before the peoples and culture of Africa. His knowledge was encyclopedic. Basically, James argues Harrison knew more and spoke and wrote more knowledgeably about Africa than any of his contemporaries, but he did so without the arrogance that so often comes from people from this country towards people of Africa. He proudly identified with his African, with the African continuities in St. Croix, and we'll get into this when we do next week. And this last one is very important, particularly for students of this history, right? For Harrison, Africa was primarily a teacher, not a primitive, unschooled child in need of civilization. This in need of civilization, when you go back and you look at the Universal Negro Improvement Association, that's Marcus Garvey's organization, founded in 1914, read the objects, number five, to civilize the people of Africa, right? Harrison is saying, yeah, Harrison's got a different approach on that. We got to learn from the Africans, right?
That was Garvey,
1914. Yeah. A radical internationalist. Hubert Harrison writes, this is Harrison as an internationalist. Although I am not satisfied with American conditions as they are now, I realize that in these days of change and unrest, I would not have been satisfied anywhere else. In China, I would be fighting against foreign domination. Egypt, India, South Africa, I would be fighting against British oligarchs. In Jamaica, against the sinister repression of black people, practices by both whites and mulattoes, Dutch, French, or American West Indies against crackers and stupidity. So he really does have this radical internationalist perspective. So overall, we're going to sum up Harrison, take a two-minute break, and we're going to move on to Alan. Race-conscious, class-conscious, scientific, internationalist emphasizes the common people. Both Harrison and Allen, common people. They write essays with affection. They're of the people, right? His approach, he's a master of the mass approach. He's reaching the masses in his day. The two principal ways you do it, soapbox, oratory, and newspapers. He's a master of each, right? Direct action and proactive, and we'll get into this much more later, but this is partly drawn from his Crucian roots, great rich history of direct action in St. Croix. Understands the interrelation of literature and the arts. He's anti-capitalist and anti-imperialist and challenges white supremacy. He understands it's central to capitalist rule. When Hubert Harrison dies in 1927, the eulogy is delivered by Arthur Schomburg, Afro-Boricua, Afro-Puerto Rican, friend of Harrison's for many years. He knows how popular Harrison's been in his day, and Schomburg eulogizes that Harrison was a